greeting, our Easter greeting is, I say, He is risen, and you say, He is risen indeed. He is risen?
He is risen indeed.
Yes, He has. A few announcements this morning that we have. We will not have youth this evening. Wednesday Bible study will resume at 6 p.m. down in the Fellowship Hall. May 1st, we're honoring the graduates. And so, just make sure that you're ready for that. And then we have a bridal shower on the 1st for Joey May and his bride-to-be. And then on the 7th, we have Collinsville Day. And we've been gearing up for that. What we're doing this year is we're going to have a booth over there across the street. And we're going to give out little bells and some to let people know that we're here. And that we're the church with bells. And then we're also going to have cups and some pens and things for them to be able to kind of identify us with. And so we need people to help work that booth. We're also, if we get enough stuff, we're going to have the youth garage sale that day as well. So if you have things to contribute to the garage sale, please bring them, and then we'll know if we have enough stuff for the garage sale. But Collinsville Day has to be a lot more important with inviting people to church that day. And so if you would like to be a part of that group that's going to be over there, we'd like you to sign up. We've got people who are going to kind of man the booth, but more people the merrier. Like if we had, not like 15 people at once, but if we had, you know, besides just the one or two people that are manning the booth, if we had at least two more that said, hey, I'll come for this hour, and then somebody else pick it up the next hour, that kind of thing. So we'd like for you to be a part of that. And if you would like to, let Wanda McPhail know, and then she will plug you in to the time and date kind of thing. The Good Neighbor Circle will meet May the 9th. Are there any other announcements that I'm missing?
Brother Ryan, when people leave today, they can take their dad's living place.
All right. And then all of the beautiful flowers that are up here have been donated in memory of people and then also in honor of some as well. And so that is in the insert of your bulletin. And we thank all of you for bringing flowers and that. You know, I think this is the prettiest one ever. Isn't that beautiful? Thank you all for making that possible.
And our young people decorated it, which are so thankful for our young people that can get up there and that are tall enough to reach the top and work so hard to get it done. So thank you.
Such a beautiful day and celebrating with God's beautiful people. Thank you for making that possible. If there are no other...
Thank you for beautiful crosses and wrapping.
You made the crosses.
Cheers.
Thank you, Ms. Cheer.
They're beautiful.
Everybody loves them. Oh, and then also, I got to say thank you to everybody who made the Easter egg hunt a great success. The kids had a big time, and then some of the big kids did as well. And we enjoyed the snow cone machine, and he brought the snow cone trailer, and Mike has really perfected his recipe. So thank you for that, and thank you for teaching him how to do it, Ms. Kimmel. We have this ongoing joke that on the way out the door, he always says to me that he's teaching her how to play the piano. So I figured she's teaching him how to do that woodwork, right? Let's reaffirm our faith together. Will you stand? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified by the dead Mary. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. Anyone else? Unspoken, please. And all the unspoken requests, the Lord knows each and every one of them, and he's going to hear your prayers and meet your needs. Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we pray for Christy Munn, and we pray for unspoken requests, and we pray for all of these different ones that are on the prayer list. And Lord, there's so many that we've got in our hearts and situations that we know about that need your mercy. And Lord, we lift those up to you right now. Lord God, I pray that you will bring healing. Lord, that you will just do miracles. Lord, we pray that you will touch people to take their faith in you more seriously. Lord, there are people who are not in church today. Lord, there are people who only come to church on Easter Sunday too. And Lord, I pray that these people will grow close to you. And Lord, there's people also who come to church every Sunday, but they may be in a place where they're stagnant in their faith, or backslidden, or lukewarm. And God, I pray that you will touch each and every one of us to grow closer to you, oh Lord. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray these things. Lord, I pray for world and country leaders. I pray, God, for the troops and their families. I pray for Ukraine's leaders and the war that's going on over there. And Lord God, I pray for Israel. And God, we pray for our leaders in this country. And I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will allow your presence to flow into us and through us. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And as you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Let's take our red hymnal again as we stand and sing hymn number 358. God, all you live. Let's sing all the way praises.
Because he lives.
Cause he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, the fear is gone. Because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll find my sign, no more it may. And then as dead gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he reigns. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth
I tell you.
Y'all turn in your Bibles to Matthew 28. And thank you for for all gathered together and praying. Whenever you close your eyes tomorrow, I want you to think about what you just saw. All your church family gathered around praying for you. Before I get started, I need to, can you hand me that camera? We need to get a picture for annual conference, one of the pictures of Easter. And I thought the easiest way to do this would be wait till all y'all are seated. I'm not too good at this, y'all. Not too good at all. I can see everybody but my little family. Y'all scoot over here. Just scoot down at the end of the row. There we go. Now we got everybody in there. John Clayton, stand up so we can see your face too in the back. All right, ready? One, two, three. One more time. One, two, three. Thank y'all. In Matthew 28, starting in verse 1. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb, and behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him, and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know you see Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. Said, come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed he is going before you into Galilee, and there you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb, and fear and great joy ran to bring his disciples word. And they went to tell his disciples, "Behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice." So they came and they held him by his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren, go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Now when they were going, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priests all the things that happened. And they had assembled the elders and consulted together. And they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers, saying, "Tell them his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if it comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure." So they took the money, and they did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age." Amen. The word of God for the people of God. This message is about the power of resurrection. Resurrection power. I'm reminded of a song, and in part of the words in that song says, "Resurrection power runs in my veins too." You know, in chapter 27, verse 52, just the previous passage before this, because of the redemptive power of Christ, there were people who actually came out of the graves in Jerusalem. And they went and they talked and they showed themselves to people. It's only one passage in the Bible that speaks to it. It's 27 verse 52. It says that the graves were opened, and many of the bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised, and coming out of the graves after his resurrection, and they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Isn't that amazing? So the graves opened up when Jesus came out of the grave. And there were certain saints of old that had come into the city, and people were able to know that Jesus is the Messiah that didn't already know. You know, the other thing is that Jesus is like a kid at Christmas time. He is absolutely excited here to go and tell the disciples something. And you have to go back to last Sunday's sermon to really understand the excitement that Jesus had. In John 16, verse 23 and 24, where we were last Sunday, it says that Jesus told the disciples, he began to tell them something right before he went to the cross. And this is his last real teaching. That's a teaching moment. And he says that in that day you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly I say to you that whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it you. Until now you have asked nothing in my name. But in that day, y'all say that with me. In that day, you will ask and you will receive that your joy may be full. So Jesus was telling them that, hey, this is not that day yet, but in that day you're going to be able to ask. But something's got to happen first. I've got one more thing that I have to do to be able to unlock this principle in the Bible for you. He had to rise from the grave. It's in the very moment that resurrection took place that principle was actuated. But he knew he had to go and tell the disciples, because they're a little bit slow to get it. And so whenever he saw people, he'd say, hey, go tell my disciples quickly that I'm risen and that I'm going to meet them in Galilee. And so they got there, and what did Jesus have to say to them? He didn't talk about what he had done in those 3 days. He didn't talk about, hey, I'm okay. I told you I was going to come back. He didn't say, he didn't say anything. He didn't say, oh, it's good to see you. All he said is, all authority has been given unto me. And you need to go to all nations. That means you need to get out of here. It's time, we've done our work here, it's time for you to leave Israel, to go to the Gentile people. Because that day that I told you about the other day, whenever I was saying that in that day, you'll be able to use the power of my name and ask of the Father, today's that day, and it's been done. I've paid the price, I've unlocked that biblical principle, and you've got it. Now go forth and use it. And that's the message that Jesus is trying to give them when he says, go forward and baptize in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So let me tell you about resurrection power. Resurrection power is the power to shrink cancer and make it disappear. It's the power to wake the dead. Resurrection power sets broken arms. Resurrection power delivers people from the power of the devil. Resurrection power delivers people from the effects of sin. Resurrection power makes people who didn't have talents previously have talents that they never thought that they could have. Resurrection power opens up blind eyes. Resurrection power can set the captive free. Resurrection power can give you peace when you thought you'd never have peace again. Resurrection power can give you strength to keep on going when you thought you'd never have the strength to keep on. You know, going back through those things, I want to tell you a few stories about those where resurrection power has been utilized. Blind eyes see. And I'm going to tell you some stories from my own perspective, because I don't want it to be a story that I'm telling you that somebody else saw. here, I don't know, it was about 9 years ago, 10 years ago, something like that. We were in Brookhaven, and it was on a Saturday night, and the Lord told me that Sunday morning we were going to see a miracle. And there was a lady in our church who needed cataract surgery. Her name was Miss Irma Smith. If anybody knows anything about down in Brookhaven, everybody in Brookhaven is either a Case or a Smith, or they're kin to them. So anyway, this lady is Miss Irma Smith. And Miss Irma needed cataract surgery, and she was no longer even able to read big print Bibles anymore. And so we laid hands on her and prayed for her, and laid hands on her and prayed for her. And we tarried. It took a while of praying. And we prayed, and we prayed until we had prayed through. And before we prayed through, we got a Bible that had the smallest print. And she was able to read it a little bit. And so we prayed for her again. And we kept doing it. You know what ended up happening? That lady was able to read the smallest print Bible we had in the church and read an entire chapter of God's Word before we left out there. She went to the doctor the next day where she was supposed to have a cataract surgery. And you know what happened? He said, there's no more cataracts in your eyes. She never had cataract surgery. She lived another 10 years before she passed away, way up in her 80s. Isn't that a blessing of the Lord? Now that is resurrection power, seeing it firsthand. You want to talk about people who don't have the talents. You might say, well, Lord, I can't do something. Lord asks you to do something, and you say, well, I can't do that. The Lord will say, well, I'll give you the grace to do it. There's a lady named Lucy. She was born astray, but she married a touchstone. Well, Miss Lucy, her mama is one of the sweetest southern ladies you ever met. And wouldn't hurt a fly, but she said, Brother Ron, my daughter couldn't carry a tune in the bucket. And she couldn't. And the Lord told her that she was going to sing and play the piano. And she said, all right, Lord, I'll do it if you'll give me the grace to do it. And one night in the middle of the night, the Lord woke her up and told her to go to the piano. And she was able to play the piano beautifully. Never touched the keys in her life. And then the Lord told her to sing that song, and she sang it, and she could sing under the anointing. Now, do y'all know what the difference is? Whenever people sing and they sound good, but yet then there's a group that whenever they sing and you can just feel all heaven come down. Kind of like what y'all just did when y'all said, we can just feel the presence of the Lord in this place. And that's the difference. There's anointed singing, and then there's by talent that they just can sing. Well, this lady's like y'all are. She can sing and the anointing comes down, and it just filled the place where you are, and you can just feel God's presence. And God did that because, you know, she said, Lord, here's my mouth, here's my hands, here's my feet. Lord, you use them. And God does it. You know, another lady that everybody should know of in the Christian music circles, Collinsworth family, y'all know them? The lady who plays the piano so beautifully for the Collinsworth, Ms. Collinsworth, can't remember her first name. Y'all remember her first name? I can't remember the first name, but I love her story. She said she was a preacher's daughter, and she said that she was just a little girl, like maybe 4 or 5. And she said that I was listening to Daddy's sermon, and she said all I remember from that Sunday night is that Daddy was talking about giving talents, and God will give you a gift. She said, that's what I heard. She said, I went to my bedroom that night, and she said, I knelt down and she told the Lord, she said, oh Lord, please give me a gift. Please. And she looked at her fingers, she said, please, 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 please. And she meant all 10 fingers, give me a gift. And over the next few weeks, the Lord just started putting it in her to go to the piano, and she started playing. And y'all just need to hear this lady play the piano. And it's so beautiful watching her when she gets done. You know how some folks, when they get done, they'll bow. She doesn't do that. You know what she does? When she gets done, just tear the piano up. She looks up
and she just praises God, and she just does like, you can tell she's just thanking Him every step of the way, because she knows that it's God who calls that. And you know, she plays better than any professional piano player I've ever heard, because she gives the glory to God. And it's under the anointing. Resurrection power. You know, delivers you from the power of the devil. I've seen people really have to deal with demonic stuff and call me in the middle of the night and call me every hour on the hour just about it. And at some point I didn't know what to pray. And I said, Lord, I'm at the end of my rope. I've prayed everything I know to pray. I've done everything I know to do. And you know what? I just started just praying in the Spirit and talking to them. And you know what? They didn't hear what I heard. And the Lord started just, and the Lord just took care of them. And all of a sudden they were free. Isn't that amazing? And God can do it. God can deliver you from whatever's going on in the demonic, if that ever happens. Sets broken arms. I got a couple of stories about that. I mean, I'm telling you, this actually happened. I remember it like it was yesterday. I was about 4 years old, and my daddy was a pastor, and we were at one of those district meetings that you have to go to. And all the preachers' wives were there, and all the preachers were there. And then when they sent the kids out after the meal, we went out on the playground to play. And they had a real tall slide. And I got up at the top of that slide, and I thought, you know, sure would be fun to jump off from here. And I did. And I landed right on that arm. And one of them, whoever was watching, just ran out there, and they picked me up, and they carried me to my daddy. And they put me in daddy's arms, and of course I'm crying. He got a broken arm. And they said, well, Brother Kitchen said, I think you're going to have to take him to the hospital. I can see you're laughing at this, because you know I'm pretty good about trying to hurt myself from this long. Won't tell y'all about cutting my finger up in this week. But anyway, so they were about to have to carry me to the hospital. And before we left, the district superintendent stood up and said, kind of like what we just did, said, I want y'all to come and gather around this family, and y'all all reach out and lay hands on this child. And they all those preachers and their wives, it's probably about 50 preachers and about 50 wives, or if it was a wife, it was a preacher, and the husband's there. And they all laid hands on me. And I can still vaguely remember even the room. And I can see them all pressing in to pray for me through my tear-filled eyes and laying hands on me and believing God for that miracle. I remember riding then in the back seat of the car to the hospital. I'm an only child, so I'm on the back seat. Mom and Dad are in the front seat. I remember sitting there, and at some point, all of a sudden, it stopped hurting. It no longer hurt, just like an instantaneous stop. And I was like, I'm okay. And they went ahead and did x-rays, and there was nothing broken. God just healed it on the way to the hospital. Second story for you, John Clayton. This happened over in Jackson. If any of y'all know the orthopedic surgeons in Jackson, probably don't, because we got such a good one here. Dr. Green's taken care of us in recent years here. He's so good. But over in Jackson, this was 7 years before we moved here. John Clayton broke his arm. They had it about set because of the power of the Lord. But then whenever it was growing back, it was bent instead of straight. And so Dr. McCluskey looked at it and he said, Brother Kitchens, we're going to have to break his arm again and put a pin in and plate and we're going to have to bring him back up here on Monday. And I said, okay. I said, well, we're a praying church and we're going to believe God for a miracle. He said, well, I believe in miracles too. You go pray and we'll still see you on Monday for surgery. So I said, okay. So we went back to the church and we were praying, And I mean, we really felt the presence of the Lord fall in that church, either Sunday morning or Sunday night. I don't remember which, but I remember it happening. And when we got back up there on Monday to go to do surgery, he came out there, told us what he's going to do, and we said, okay. And so he went in, and they, he'd probably been back there maybe 15 minutes. And Dr. McCluskey, he's one of those that's super smart. You know, the kind that they're not too sociable, but they only know about the one thing, you know. And he came out, and he was wringing his hands, and, Brother Kitchens, I'm sorry. I said, it's okay. What's going on? And he said, I'm sorry I put your son to sleep, but we put him to sleep, and then we thought we ought to do an x-ray again. I knew I already did one on Friday, but I thought I might ought to do one again just before we opened him up. And he said, and when I did this x-ray just now, that he doesn't need anything, so all we did was rewrap him back up, and he'll be awake in a few minutes. I said, it's okay. We kind of expected that. Remember, we were praying in church, and God just did another miracle. Hallelujah. He didn't, God straightened him. You know, that's the kind of God that we serve. Then, got to tell you one more about waking the dead. There's a, I can't pronounce the last name. If our African brother and sisters were here today, they could pronounce it for us, but they're not. This happened in Nigeria. This man's name is Daniel. Now here's the last name. E-K-E-C-H-U-K-W-U. I kid you not, that's the spelling. Dan. We'll call him Brother Daniel. Brother Daniel's a black preacher. And Brother Daniel had a terrible car wreck. And he was alive. They put him in an ambulance, came to the hospital, they were carrying back to his doctor, his family practitioner, because that's where they wanted to go. On the way in the ride back to the family practitioner, he dies. They carry him to the mortuary. He's in the mortuary for 3 days. And his wife said, there's a revival meeting that I want to take my husband to. They said, ma'am, your husband's dead. Said, yeah, I want you to go get the body, and we're going to carry him over there to that revival meeting, because I know that the presence of the Lord's going to be there. And if the Lord did it then in the Bible, he can do it today. And if it's going to happen, it's going to happen in that church house. So they actually brought the hearse to the church. There's thousands of people in the sanctuary. It's a huge sanctuary. And she wanted to carry him in the sanctuary. They said, no, ma'am, we're not going to let you bring him in the sanctuary. So they said, but we will let you do this. We'll let you get him out of the casket and just bring him into the fellowship hall, and we'll lay him down there, and you can pray for him there. Because if God's here, and God's power can do it, he can do it down here just as good as he can do it upstairs. And so they actually laid him out on the table. Well, they were praying. The preacher upstairs didn't even know he's down there. And all of a sudden, he starts breathing. And then they said that Rick Gordon, you know, had said in so. Remember, he's been dead for 3 days. And but hey, Lazarus was too. So this isn't unheard of, is it? And that's why we're here today, because we know Jesus was too, and Jesus raised himself up. And so anyway, they said they began to try to work his limbs and massage his, and they said they could feel the warmth when it came back into his fingers. And then they had him on video telling his miracle story of what happened, you know, months later, because he's fine and he's able to continue to preach the word. Isn't that just wonderful? But that's the kind of miraculous power that's resurrection power. And that's what we believe, that God can do it. And if he was able to raise himself up, he's more than able to raise you and me up. And, you know, I just love that song, as I was telling you a minute ago. It's called Rattle. If you've heard it. It says, resurrection power flows in my veins too. I hear the sound of dry bones rattling. Can you just imagine Lazarus hearing his name called out, and all of a sudden he just had to get up and come forth? Isn't that amazing? Eugene O'Neill, back in the 1930s, if I'm not mistaken, wrote a play called Lazarus Laughed. And through the whole play, Lazarus is just really laughing just near about everything. And then every now and then they'll ask him, Lazarus, why are you laughing? And he says, because I'm Lazarus and I live. There's no death, only life. Does that make sense to you? That when we close our eyes in death, it says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So the very second you shut your eyes, you open them in glory in the presence of the Lord if you're in Christ. Is that not beautiful? There is no death, only life. So at the end of the play, it ends like this. Lazarus' wife is dying. And for a moment, he starts to shed some tears because he knows his wife is going to be gone now from him. But then he begins to laugh again. And then pretty soon, his wife opens her eyes and she too starts laughing. And she says, Lazarus, you're right. There is no death, only life. And then she closes her eyes again and she's back in the presence of the Lord. No death, only life. And how does Lazarus know? Because he says, I'm Lazarus and I live. And I'm here to tell you that one of these days we are going to pass away, but we're going to pass from this life into the next. And to be absent from the body is going to be present with the Lord. And just like Jesus told the thief on the cross, this day you will be with me in paradise. But you know, so many times people take it for granted. I saw a fellow yesterday, and I knew he didn't go to church. But I've known him long enough, I thought I could talk to him like this. And I said to him, I said, you're going to be in church in the morning, aren't you? And he said, no, I work two jobs, and I'm not going to be in church on Easter morning. I'm going to be in bed. And I said to him, I said, you know, Jesus died on the cross for you. And he rose up from the grave so you don't have to burn in hell. And you can't be in church on Easter Sunday morning. And he said, and then he gave me a good old cop-out answer. And he said, well, the Lord knows my heart, but he doesn't go to church. And I just looked at him. I didn't have anything else to say. How sad for people to take Jesus' blood for granted. How sad for people to take his resurrection for granted. You know, the Lord loves us. And we need to show the world just how much we love Him. And so this day, if you need to rededicate your life, if you need that resurrection power in a certain area of your life, or to set you free, or if you're in a rut and you need to get out of that rut, that resurrection power can do it. And it can turn your life totally around right this second. In the presence of the Lord, there's fullness of joy. In the presence of the Lord, there's peace forevermore. In the presence of the Lord, you don't have to worry. And you can take that presence everywhere you go. Walking, living, talking, sleeping in Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that we would walk in your presence, Lord, that we sit in your presence, that we sleep in your presence, that we stand, that we run, that we drive, everything we do, O Lord, I pray that it's in your presence. Oh God, I pray that you go before us. Lord, I pray that from this moment forward, that as we're here today, and Lord, I look around and so many people I know their lives are right with you as far as being saved. Lord, if they're here today and they need to rededicate their life, I pray that they'll say, yes, Lord. I do that. I make that commitment once again in my heart to you. Make me new. Cleanse me. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I pray that as we go forth from this place, Lord, that we remember that we're Easter people. Because of resurrection, and that resurrection power flows in my veins too, because of what the lady said.
I've just seen Jesus.
Our hymn of invitation, hymn number 319, Hear the Cross. Let's stand and sing. The first and second stanza, hymn number 319.
The way we live, in Jesus' name.